All right, so this is going to be another episode of Jump Box. I've got lots of different things that have popped up recently, and we just kind of need to get all those together and throw them in the box so we can move on to something else. So if you don't follow me on Instagram, then you don't know about this. And this very innocent looking part was intended to hold the Loop Alien hand stamp that you may or may not have seen in the half inch depth of cut KR33 CNC video I did probably a month back. A lot of people mentioned you need some kind of holder to hold the stamp to make it easier, make it faster. 100% agreed, and this is what I came up with. Now, this is a failure on multiple levels. Some of it is design, some of it is capacity, some of it is machining capability, you name it. So all we needed to do was have a 6mm shaft, some sort of apparatus to hold the stamp, and then we could, you know, it would hold it in the same position every time, and so all we got to do is load a Loop Alien, pop it, get it out, load another one, pop it. It would just make it go so much faster, and the stamp consistency was going to be better, so that we've got a consistent position and depth and all of that. That was the plan. So the design flaw on my part was these wings that are left here to hold the stamp or to pinch the stamp with these two 8mm grub screws, they're not thick enough. So when I clamped down on it, especially this one, this just kicks out and it was like worthless. So I was able to use the top one to kind of really pinch it and hold it in place. So when I put it in the stamp, or the impact press, and an impact press, if you don't know what it is, if you're familiar with a center punch, and I have one over here, I think. Yes, there it is. All right, so a center punch, a spring-loaded center punch, is just something that you push on, and that's going to be loud in the microphone, isn't it? So you push on it, and it reaches a point where it has an anvil or a hammer in the back that as you push it, it's loading that up, and then when you get it so far, it snaps and fires back. And so it leaves a nice little dent. So if you're trying to drill something in metal, you always want to center punch it, or at least hand punch it if you've got to be really, really precise, because it gives you a good starting point for the drill. So an impact press is like a drill press combined with that thing. So you have a drill press type setup where you've got the flat base, you've got a column, you've got the arm over it. And so as you pull the level, or as you pull the lever, it's pushing down, it's pushing down, and then you reach a point where the striker hits, and it just fires and pops it, just like that one just popped that piece of aluminum. So, but in this case, it's forcing a stamp into the metal, not a center punch. So I think that little one that I got it off of eBay. I want to say that it's 500 pounds, maybe strike force. It's one of the smallest ones that you can get, and you can dial that back if you need it. If people use it for jewelry, all kinds of stuff. But it does work, so I was glad to find it, and it makes for, even in the way that it is now, it makes for a more consistent strike. So, all right, so I'm getting off track. So back to this. So when I actually put this in there, you know, this little thing, this little impact press is tiny. It's like the smallest drill press you've probably ever seen. And so this is the largest size tool that the collet that's on this impact press will hold. So by the time I've got this and the little dainty little collet, I've got this big hunk of steel hanging out, and then I've got a hunk of hardened steel that's the stamp hanging out. You know, it's kind of wiggling around and whatnot. And when I would strike it, there was so much weight here that it messed up the strike, I guess the strike method that it's using, and it would bounce and actually double strike. So at that point, I'm like, waste of time, but lesson learned, and you can't win them all. So the reason this exists, and I didn't throw my Harbor Freight mini mill across the yard, was because I was running the Air Mover 3000, and I could actually stand being down here because it was like 86 degrees. But as long as that fan was blowing, you know, it was perfectly fine. It kept the air moving. It wasn't cold down here, but it definitely helped. So I ran that thing for probably a couple of hours. It started making noise, and I'm like, why is it doing that? So I go and I cut it. Well, first thing I did was I shot it with the temperature gun. I'm like, okay, is it heating up? Shot it with the temperature gun. It was kind of in the normal range, and I'm like, okay. I turned it off, and the fan spun, and it went, hick. And it just completely stopped. Normally those things take several seconds to spin down. Not this time. It may have made it around one time and it completely stopped. I tried to turn it back on and it never moved again. So I'm thinking the bearings are shot in that motor, even though we just got that thing going. But there's no bearings in this at all. These are all bushings on the ends. But you imagine how long these things run. So something's got to be up. So as I was looking at this thing, I'm like, well, what are these things? And it says top right here. And so all of this started to make sense rather quickly. And again, me not being a motor guy or an AC guy, I do have another motor, the Bodine motor that I used for the parts tumbler I made. It had a certain orientation that it had to run in. Well, when I took these apart, I found out very quickly what these are. These are actually oilers. These are just little aluminum caps, and there's channels that run all the way down to the bushing in here, and there is a hole in the bushing or a cutout in the bushing that allows the oil to get down to the shaft. And so there's a wiper or a gasket membrane that kind of hugs the shaft on the backside as well as the front side, and there's one on the inside facing the guts of the motor as well. So was it just running dry? No, it was actually worse than that. As this was in the Air Mover 3000, the motor was like this. So where'd all the oil go? It all just basically dried up and ran out. There was nothing left in here. I'm sure this thing probably never has been oiled. And since it says top right here, it all kind of makes sense. So I'm thinking it was just running dry. There didn't seem to be any scarring on the drive shaft or anything. So I'm going to reorient the motor inside the housing to where the fillers are actually up, and we'll put it all back together, reroute the wiring accordingly, and we'll see if it can come back to life. So we'll see. So what I did is I took all this stuff apart. You saw that I had the motor out of it. I've got the oil or the oiler channels almost at 12 o'clock. It got a little cattywampus, but there was no real good way to know how far to put the motor in this way. And it was kind of an eyeball kind of thing to figure out how to get it up, but this is close enough. I think what was making the thing worse was that these were all the way down here, straight down, and I didn't get a shot of it before I put the motor back together. But if you look down in, it had this smooth bushing. I'm not sure what it was made out of, but it had a slot or a almost like a channel cut out of it to allow the oil to come down this tube and get inside where the shaft is. So I would have to think that if it ran dry because it was upside down and it had no capability of retaining anything, that was part of it. The other part would be the fact that the downward force of the motor, or just gravity in general, is pulling down on an area of the bushing that's not complete because it had, it's missing a chunk to let the oil come in. So I would imagine that would also not be good. So she spins quite freely now, which she was not doing that before. Still spinning, and it finally stops. So even before I took the motor apart, it wasn't spinning that good, even though it was still a little bit free. So I think what had happened was it just ran dry, it got hot, or at least the bushings got hot, and that was causing the wear. So after reorienting everything, I had to move the capacitor, moved it down, it was right here, moved it down. Ground wires are over here tied together. Didn't have to do anything with the wiring except unplug it and plug it back in. So that worked out. So it's plugged in, and I did do a test run. So let's hear it. Got all my junk everywhere. All right, so our indicator is lit, so we're ready to go. So medium. That's the wind blowing some stuff over there that you hear. So now we'll do high. So it's working again. So I'll put it back over in the corner and we'll see how long it goes before it starts doing something else. So crisis averted.
The other part was, somebody left a comment today on this very subject, was, hey, you know, they make other bits for 22 millimeter, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, I'm right there with you. And I actually thought about that last week. The more I thought about cutting that hole out, and yeah, you know, I hope you can appreciate the hack I showed you where I was using that rasp to open that hole up, because that's always going to happen. Sometimes you just have to improvise, and I kind of love improvising, not as much as having the right tool. I always love having the right tool, but in this kind of, I'm not going to be defeated by this problem, I'll find another way to do it. That's fun to me. It's frustrating sometimes, but it is fun in a sick and twisted kind of way. So this guy had mentioned another bit, and I'm like, okay, we were on the same page last week. So what he was talking about was a uni bit or a step bit. So this happens to be an Irwin, I think it's model 4MT. Very nice bit, you know, kind of the standard. You see these at a lot of home centers, and this one goes, it's actually less than, it goes 4 millimeter to 22 millimeter. So there right there is our 22 millimeter hole for the next time that we have to do a panel. So awesome. And that was a great idea. And I found a knockoff. This one's in Imperial. So this one goes actually 1/4 inch to 1 3/8. So this was chump change compared to what the Irwin cost, but this is a knockoff. It actually has two flutes. Doesn't even have a name on it. I'm surprised it even has the markings. So I got both of those. And so the next time that we have to do a panel like we did for the Air Remover 3000, that'll make super fast work of it. Bam, bam, psh, and put the switches in and we're done. No more fiddle farting, no more using a rasp to kind of open those holes up and getting them kind of oblong. Those days are over. Another reason I went ahead and sprung for those is at some point I've got to create a panel for the KR33 Mini CNC. Right now the power supplies, which it has three, the power supplies, e-stop, servo motors, servo power, servo signal, servo home, brake, solenoid for the air, power for the spindle. I mean, everything has got to poke through an enclosure. And it's probably going to be a steel enclosure. I snagged one off of eBay some time ago for a really good deal, but it's not that big and I don't know that I can get everything in it. So I'm still looking for an enclosure, and I don't even care if it's plastic. But you generally want them to be bigger. You want them to be a little bit oversized so you've got room to work in it and route your cabling and your wires correctly and kind of keep it nice and neat. And if you have to add something to it, it gives you some expansion room. So I don't know, I need to find something like that. But those uni bits are gonna be awesome for that, because I'll be able to just pop those holes in the sheet metal or plastic very easily and be able to put all the wire relief retainers and all that stuff, switches, indicators, MPG, whatever we put on the box, it'll just make fast work of it. So that was a good call. So thank you for the comment on that. And I know that's going to serve us well.